Tarzan of the Apes, brought to you from out the pages of Edgar Rice Burroughs' thrilling book. The hot, steamy air of a jungle afternoon hangs like a grayish blue haze in the treetops. On the edge of the great waterhole, crocodiles, their vicious snouts barely showing above the surface, wait for the unwary beast that comes to cool itself in the sluggish water. The shrill piping of the birds is deadened by the smothering fall of heat. The monkeys, almost always active, doze in their nests high in the tangled branches. On the little platform before Jane's resting place, Tarzan sits examining his grass rope while Jane Porter thinks of the voices she had heard in the jungle.
The more I think about it, the more convinced I am that it's one daddy out looking for me.
Me? Me?
No, White Skin. I was just talking to myself.
Myself? Myself?
Myself. Me. Jane.
White Skin. Me?
Yes.
White Skin. Myself?
Yes.
Myself? Me. White Skin. Many White Skin.
Yes, White Skin. Oh, no, no. Only one.
Jane, me? Jane, myself?
No, no, no.
Tarzan nods to show that he understands there is a difference, although he does not understand what that difference is. And then Jane takes the grass rope into her hand.
Jane, take rope.
Take. Jane, take rope. White Skin, take rope.
And Tarzan takes the rope from Jane's hand as he says the word.
That's right, White Skin. Take. Now we will see if you understand this. White Skin, take Jane's hut.
For a moment, Tarzan sits puzzled.
White Skin, take Jane hut. White Skin, take Jane hut.
Then Tarzan looks up at Jane. The flash in his eyes tells her that he understands.
White Skin, Jane, to go hut quick. Come back quick.
Yes, White Skin, you've got it. Come quick, go hut. Go hut.
What Jane can want at the hut, Tarzan does not know, but he understands that she's excited, and too, he needs more long grasses to make a new rope, and these grasses grow on the headland beyond the hut. He bends down, picks Jane gently from her feet, and holding her as easily as if she were a baby, he starts into the heavily interlaced branches of the lower jungle terrace. In the cannibal kraal, Professor Porter, Philander Clayton, and D'Arno discuss their predicament.
Are you quite sure, D'Arno? It's incredible.
I'm not surprised. I've believed it all along.
I have no way of being certain, monsieur, as to the truth of these black assertions, but I am quite certain as to what he said.
Although, of course, I do not understand his language, I nevertheless detected not only his extreme surprise, but his fear, with almost a note of terror.
He was terrified. He said that he was one of the party that had captured Philander. That is, he said you, the big heavy man. Then he went on to explain how they were carrying you through the jungle when one of them was pulled into the trees by an unseen power and hurled upon them. And then many of them were killed by arrows and they fled. They blamed the devil god.
Yes. That scene is graven deeply on my mind. Amazing fortitude on his part.
Well, what next did he say?
Yes, about Jane. He said that he was separated from the party and was on his way through the jungle when again this devil god dropped on his shoulders, took his bow and arrows, and was about to kill him when a white woman in the treetop shouted something. The black did not understand what she said, but the devil god did, for he put the black down. This fellow ran here, he said, without even looking back. Then the white woman must be Jane.
Let us pray that it is. Still, we hardly expected to find a white man in the jungle. Isn't it logical to suppose that he may have a primitive mate?
That may be, Clayton. But something tells me the woman is Jane. It must be.
If Monsieur Clayton and Monsieur Philander will allow me to finish.
Oh, I beg your pardon.
Certainly.
I was about to observe that the native used the word Memsad in referring to the white woman. Now, that word is used among these tribes almost exclusively for a white European woman. Had the white woman been a skin-clad savage, the native would not have used the polite
word. Ah, the blessed certainty of knowing that Jane is alive.
Relief. Relief is hardly adequate to express my feelings.
It's a great relief to all of us. But don't forget, we're on the wrong side of this cannibal stockade. Our arms, no one knows where. And we have all the earmarks of becoming just another meal for a bunch of cannibals.
Clayton, you're becoming a regular pessimist.
Well, I'm dashed if I can see anything to be optimistic about in the face of this situation. Naturally, I'm as glad... Well, there are no words to convey my joy at knowing that Jane is alive.
Yeah, but once our purpose, was it not? To find Mademoiselle Jane? Well, now that we know she is not here, and since we no longer have to fear the black sweep triathlons on Mademoiselle Jane, voila, we can fight.
That's all nonsense, Donovan, you know it. When we came in here, fully armed, you said that we were hopelessly outnumbered. Now we are disarmed. The sailors are disarmed, and in a different hut. There are more blacks than there were before, and you talk of fighting.
There certainly is something to your argument, Clayton. In fact, now that we are assured of Jane's safety, for the moment at least, possibly it behooves us to decide upon some plan of action, some campaign that will lead to our eventual release.
Any plan of action that will get me out of this decidedly evil-smelling hut meets with the heartiest approval of Samuel T. Philander.
Then to work. I know nothing of cannibals and their practices, but for the past hour, something has been going on out there in the compound, and it looks to me like...
Let me see, Clayton. Yes, there is certainly unwanted activity. Peculiar sort of fellow out there. Witch doctor. Going through the most awful antics and contortions. Circling a fire with some sort of clay idol in the middle of it.
Monsieur, monsieur, are you certain?
The water is right. I've been watching it for some time.
Mon Dieu, it is right. There is not a moment to lose. We must act at once.
As serious as all that, not
up yet. That is the ceremony that precedes the sacrifice. Ah, then during the sacrifice will be our best time to escape.
No, Professor. What Dano means is that preparations are being made to sacrifice. Ah!
Making his way with a speed in these almost unbelievable, Tarzan carries Jane closer and closer to the hut. They reach the clearing where Turkoz, the bull ape, captured Jane. Tarzan holds the girl close as he drops through the leafy screen of verdure to the ground. He places her on her feet, and Jane, holding the ape man's arm, looks up into his face.
Here, Turkoz, take Jane. Whiteskin, save Jane.
Whiteskin, kill Turkoz. Save Jane. Save Jane?
Yes, Whiteskin, save.
No, kill. Save. Jane, save. Go, man, Ganny. Jane, save man.
Yes, Whiteskin. Jane, save man. Whiteskin, no kill. Come, go quick, hut.
They move forward again. Through the sparse trees skirting the clearing, Jane sees the hut. Suddenly she stumbles, bends down.
Look, Whiteskin. Revolver. Gun. Bang, bang.
Gun. Bang, bang.
Yes. This is the gun I dropped when Turkoz captured me. Of course you don't understand. Turkoz, take Jane. Jane, frighten. Gun, fall.
And Jane drops the gun to the ground as she says fall. Tarzan bends down to get the gun, but Jane steps forward quickly.
No, Whiteskin, no.
Gun, kill?
Yes, Whiteskin.
Whiteskin, go rope. Jane, go hut?
Yes, Whiteskin. You go and get the grass for your rope. I'll go to the hut.
Whiteskin, come back quickly.
All right, Whiteskin. Come back quickly. Jane, go hut.
And as Tarzan goes off to the headland for a new supply of the long, tough grasses from which he weaves his ropes, Jane enters the hut.
It doesn't look as though they've been back here. Yet I'm almost certain I heard Daddy's voice. It's quite possible that they're out in the jungle now. Of course, there's no real reason why they should come back to the hut every day, but no, there's no real reason. I wonder where they put that on. It's revolver, dusty, but I'm sure that... Oh, here it is. Now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 live shells. Who can tell? Someday they may save my life. Or... I can use them to signal me. What's that?
Jane stands transfixed as the door slowly opens, revealing the menacing figure of a gigantic black. Jane backs against the wall of the hut, terrified. As the door opens wide, she sees gathered behind him the hideous faces of a party of savage warriors.